Good morning, security savants, and welcome back to Chain Guard Assembled. We are here steaming through an exciting day of live coverage. My name is Savannah Peterson. Really pumped up to be joined with Jackie McGuire.
Hey.
You are just, your energy is as positive as your glitter bomb today.
Yeah, I am leaving a trail of blue glitter everywhere I go. It's on my hands. Whoever sits in the seat's gonna get it. But this is the prom dress I always wanted, and Chain Guard has, their colors are blue, so I thought I would. It has pockets.
I like this.
This is true progress. This prom dress has pockets.
And I'm really glad that a security conference can bring you the prom you didn't have. Maybe that glitter is like the data that's at risk if you don't
have
Chain Guard solutions.
Yeah.
It's just out there lonely. Million
These are people. All your unpatched vulnerabilities because you're using distros.
Exactly. Speaking of glittery personalities, we've got Dustin Kirkland back on the show.
Wow.
Dustin, always a pleasure. I'm a little sad we're not in Paris today. That's where I got to hang out with you last time.
No, not this time. San Francisco.
I know, we're doing our best. You are here in this particular segment to break down all of the announcements from today, talk about the innovation that's going on. You were just in the keynote. Give us some of the highlights.
Yeah, so, man, it was a packed agenda. Dan Lawrence, our co-founder, CEO, kicked things off. Brought us a little bit of the how we got here, then the background, the founding story for Chain Guard. We announced a new partnership with Datadog, super interesting and exciting. He announced two new products beyond Chain Guard's containers, also Chain Guard VMs, Chain Guard virtual machines, so hardened virtual machines, including.
Hot part of the keynote this morning was
about these. Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And Chain Guard libraries, being able to build Java archives, jars, from source and securing those. We've had a couple of customers join us on stage as well. So yeah, let's dig in.
Talk to me, actually I want to talk about those customer stories. Are these folks that have already implemented what you announced today?
Yeah.
So what are you seeing so far in the initial MVP prototypes here?
So, you know, the customer we had on stage, Dylan from Booz Allen, they've been a phenomenal partner of ours. Chain Guard is a piece of a bigger puzzle that the Booz Allen team is bringing into the government and the DoD specifically. We supply them with hardened container images, including FIPS-approved cryptography, and that's essential. It's a requirement for running these containers in production in the U.S. government, U.S. allies, and the Chain Guard piece is a key component of that. And Booz Allen's been a phenomenal partner here.
I'm curious. Do you get to touch customers across industry verticals and spaces.
For sure.
Do you find there are any different patterns between the public sector, private, startups? What do you?
For sure. The compliance obligations often drive the value. I see that resonates with you, Jackie.
I come from finance. So
yeah, there you go. So
nerd.
Finance, healthcare, for sure. I've spent some time in finance as well. The obligations that one has in a regulated industry, be that healthcare, finance, government, even private sector, customer retail, just customer data, those are extremely high stakes obligations, meaning if you don't get it right, then you don't get to do business. You don't get to do business to start, you don't get to do business any longer, you potentially are obliged or liable for penalties. And what Chain Guard offers in terms of our secure hardened container images is a way of meeting and exceeding many of those requirements. So taking this back to the federal sector, our SLA, our service level agreements and contracts are designed to exceed the FedRAMP mandates for CVE, security vulnerability remediation. And even for customers in industries that aren't subject to FedRAMP itself, finance and healthcare, the fact that we exceed FedRAMP by so much often, almost always, exceeds their requirements under their regulatory frameworks.
Yeah, I totally agree. Coming from a vendor, customers would frequently ask us if we were FedRAMP, even though they weren't federal customers,
right,
because that's kind of a seal of approval.
Yeah.
Well, if they're FedRAMP, they check all the other boxes.
That's right.
So it's not a big deal.
That's right.
And it's not easy. I think, when I came from data science and they don't teach you, hey, when you spin up an image, make sure it's secure. It's
right.
Just like, it's super easy to just spin up an image and
right.
Push a bunch of data science code. So I appreciate the minimalistic approach.
Yeah, most
to
of our
it.
Customers have to pick and choose which vulnerabilities they're going to address. And for the most part, they're able to address the most critical, the highest ones, but then there's this long tail of mediums and lows that they're not able to address until they upgrade, mm-hmm. from the last segment we were talking about, until they upgrade to a new major version. Mm-hmm. And instead, with the ChainGuard approach, we're updating these constantly, all day, every day, and so every day there's a new one that remediates the rest of the vulnerabilities that might have shown up yesterday. And so the scanners literally go from hundreds of unpatched vulnerabilities in a non-ChainGuard image to zero or one or two that are works in progress. And our SLA says that we'll remediate criticals within 7 days, high, mediums, and lows within 14 days. And that exceeds the FedRAMP requirements of 30, 90, and 120 days, which is a long time. We're talking 4 months.
I was just going to say, that seems shockingly long.
Yep.
And also, really significant decrease in working with you on those requirements. Than that. It feels like a really long time to be vulnerable.
Yeah, and I think
a quarter?
A lot of, it's crazy, and I think a lot of what that comes from is if you're a very large company, it could take that long just to figure out, you know, you have multi-cloud, you have all of these different teams using different containers that are set up in different ways. And I, correct me if I'm wrong, but I have found that a lot of times those vulnerabilities exist in services that container didn't necessarily need anyway.
Oh yeah.
Which is why you guys have gone with this minimalistic strategy is that you just spin up a generic container and you've probably got 100 things in there that you don't actually need to do the very specific thing you're doing in that container. And that, I imagine, not just creates a lot of overhead from a manpower standpoint, but also just a cloud cost standpoint.
Yep.
So I assume you're also saving tons of...
We're often 90% smaller than the alternative free image in Docker Hub. Mm-hmm. You know, so our Python image, there was a screenshot from one of our features called our CVE visualization dashboard, which will take any ChainGuard image and compare it to the equivalent upstream default open source one on Docker Hub. The Python one was 23 megabytes compressed compared to the upstream default one, which was almost 300 megabytes compressed. So that's one of the three ways we use to remediate vulnerabilities. One is just making it smaller, removing code that you don't need from that container, and in doing so, you remove tons of potential access points or places where code could be vulnerable. The second piece is we update aggressively, and this is, you know, the rolling distro approach, always adopting latest and greatest open source releases as quickly as possible, testing, signing, delivering those as quickly as possible. The third one is about providing CVE advisories. So ChainGuard is a trusted source of advisory information that the scanners, Sneak and Wiz and Prisma and Trivy and JFrog X-Ray, each of those consume feeds of information from ChainGuard where we can definitively tell, after doing our research and documenting, whether some code is known vulnerable and we're waiting on a fix, or known false positive, hey, this code path is not executed, we have compiler flags that remediate against this, this is only vulnerable on 32-bit Windows and we are not 32-bit Windows. There's a lot of those, but we have to tell the scanner to do that.
Right.
It's hard work, but we invest in that work and our customers appreciate it in that they've got, you know, much more accurate scanner results.
Yeah, we see that a lot because if you don't have context, you just get fatigued, right? Because if everything is an alert and
That's
you
right.
see the same 45 alerts every day, when the 46th one pops up, you don't always notice it. I see that a lot. I wanted to talk a little bit more about the Datadog partnership, coming from an observability vendor.
Yeah.
Observability is a huge piece of security. And so I, coming into an observability vendor from security, I was like, I don't even understand what observability has to do with security.
Yeah.
I am happy to say, I was a data scientist, guys, not a security engineer. So I'm now happy to say that I understand more, but I wonder if you could talk about that, about Datadog and observability and how that ties to the great work that you guys are doing
with
containers.
You can't, it's really hard to secure what you're not able to see or what you're not able to observe. And so,
fumbling around in the dark, trying to,
Right. And
quite literally in some cases.
Yeah. And the scanners help with one part of that observability, you know, seeing what mapping those CVEs to vulnerable versions. But what the Datadog partnership does is it helps our customers have more introspection into what's actually running in their environment. So we have a bunch of customers and prospects that we start engaging with them on the technical sales and pre-sales process, and it turns out they don't even know how many containers they're running in production, where those are coming from, you know, where, what versions are they running. And so that's one of the first pieces is you know, we've got a number of customers that we started with a year or two ago. They used ChainGuard in two or three places, and then they said, wow, this is great. Where else could we use, where else, you know, are we vulnerable and we could replace those images with ChainGuard images? And some of those customers had no real way of inventorying what they're actually running. And so this Datadog partnership and the visualization process that they have helps expose that and shows the opportunities for places where security is not as high as it could be.
It's really getting things out of silos in that instance and letting people have a real proper full lay of the complete lay of the land. Does the partnership with Datadog accelerate your velocity and what you're able to deliver to customers? Are you going to be co-innovating on some of these solutions as well?
Yeah, I think, you know, we saw that in the keynote, you know, the co-development of that first product. I think we can then start to get into the other two products that we've announced today, the ChainGuard libraries, the ChainGuard VMs. Right now, the Datadog visualization piece is only for the containers, but yeah, we should talk about those the other new products because that's super exciting in terms of the breadth of this software supply chain that we're now securing.
Yeah, let's talk about the libraries first.
Yeah.
Big innovation for you guys there today. Break it down for us.
Yeah, this is super interesting. Dan used the analogy of you know, anyone who's taken a security certification class, which we're all obligated to do now at work. You know, there's always the cheesy segment where someone finds a USB stick on the sidewalk, and you know, we tell our employees, you know, don't plug that USB stick into your laptop, and certainly if you do, don't click on the run.exe that's installed on that, right? However, we laugh, but that's exactly what's happening all day, every day, every time anyone uses pip install or maven add or npm install of some third-party software package that's coming from not a source that your IT or security department has necessarily blessed. And so what the ChainGuard Libraries product is solving is that problem exactly. So what we've announced today is Java, and that's our, you know, it's the most important starting point for us from what we've heard from our customers in terms of the scope of the problem. Java's used everywhere in the enterprise, especially in the financial services industry, for sure. Most of those companies are building their own, writing their own Java software, their own proprietary code, but depending on open source libraries from you know, a tool like Maven, Maven add, go fetch some other jar files, almost half of that code is estimated to have been built not by a secure builder, but literally on someone's laptop or desktop. Yeah. And so we're solving that problem. We're taking all of that code, we're building it from source, ensuring that it is repeatable. We're scanning it with multiple different static source code analysis and malicious content scanners at the source code level, ensuring that it can be built, which means that it can be patched, which means we could take a change that fixes a thing and apply that. That's not guaranteed if you're not building from source. Building that with our tool chain, rebuilding that constantly, and then integrating that. And so our customers are now able to point their artifact repository, Artifactory or CloudSmith or something like that, and continue using Maven, but pointing to, you know, a ChainGuard trusted source of libraries. Starting with Java, we're you know, soliciting feedback from customers on what they'd like to see next. Python, Node are certainly leading candidates.
I know I'm biased because I'm a data scientist, but please, Python.
Python, okay.
I knew you were going to say that.
Well, yeah. So I did the UC Berkeley data science boot camp. So I did a 6-month, pretty intense data science boot camp, and at the end, I built a really cool machine learning model that got me a job at a sim.
Yep.
And when I turned in my first detection model at that sim, my CEO looked at me like I had a hole in my head because my code was just like hard-coded secrets and, like, you know, it just was trash from a security perspective, using all kinds of rando libraries I saw on Stack Overflow and GitHub. And
you made it work, man.
Yeah, I made it work, but I think, you know, doing what we can do to protect people from themselves, or to not assume, one, I think we need to educate a lot more people on security, but also to understand that people building in the cloud and spinning up containers don't always necessarily come from an IT and security background.
Right.
I would love to be protected
myself. And they're under intense pressure, you know, to ship, to get it, to solve a problem, to get something done, and, you know, there's no fault in Git clone a third-party repository of pip install until, you know, that introduces inadvertently you know, a backdoor or data exfiltration or something like that, you know?
I think it's just like the app stores, you know, for a lot of the mobile devices is you assume that because it's in there, it's safe, right? Pip would never have anything. And that's, I was not aware until I worked in security that PIP was just a way to get these things. It wasn't any type of assurance that they were okay.
Right.
I learned a lot, thankfully.
Well, and we're grateful you share that with us here on the news desk. You mentioned the VMs loosely, but I want to dive in there a little bit deeper before we let you go. What's the benefit to the enterprise with this new offering?
Yeah, so in addition to hardening those libraries and the containers, we're also building secure virtual machine images, which takes this down a couple levels in the stack, ensuring that we're building a Linux kernel from source with our own C libraries and compiler hardening flags. Doing so against multiple build targets, all three of the public clouds, as well as VMware and QMU virtualization, applying hardening flags to those kernel configs, and rebuilding that kernel following the upstream security release tree. So ensuring that as soon as there is any CVE mitigated or fixed in the Linux kernel, we're rebuilding that within minutes of Greg Kohartman tagging that release upstream, putting it through our testing, and then re-rolling those images typically within under an hour of it actually being released upstream. That velocity is unmatched anywhere. So that's the kernel piece. There's also the requirements to boot the system, SBIN init, that's systemd. We've targeted the first workload for those virtual machines being a container host. Why? Because we run a lot of containers, and what we heard from our customers was over and over and over again, hey, that thing you've done for our containers and eliminated all the vulnerabilities, could you do that for the VMs underneath? Because our container scans are clean, still have all of these vulnerabilities in our Amazon Linux or, you know, Red Hat hosts or something like that. So we've hardened systemd, containerd, the kubelet, the pieces needed to run the worker nodes. And we're right now we've announced and offering the general availability within Amazon EKS, their Elastic Kubernetes service. So you can bring your own ChainGuard nodes to that service. And for those ChainGuard nodes that are running ChainGuard on the VM and ChainGuard in the container, you can really get to a zero vulnerability entire stack.
I imagine it's also significantly more cost effective.
I mean, especially when you look at the potential cost of a breach or, you know, the negative headlines of having allowed a security breach when, you know, there were fixes available for this vulnerability.
That peace of mind is priceless, not to mention the cost associated with something like that. Final question for you, Dustin. If you could wave a magic wand and dispel one myth in the security world right now, or upskill and educate the community on one thing like that, what would you say, or what would that be?
Dispel a myth. Oh man, so I gotta think of something that's false.
That is a myth.
And then fix it for everyone.
Yes, you have the opportunity right now, you have a platform.
Or that people don't know there's a solution for, so people are using
something else. I think I'm gonna double down on the USB stick analogy, which is that the software that you're running in production is secure. It's not if you're not getting that from a trusted source, and it's hard to do that when you need information and data and binaries and tools and compilers and libraries from a bunch of different sources. It's very cobbled together. It works, and it works, you know, well enough. But if you really take a look at it, there's a lot of potential points of security, vulnerability there.
All right, well, we'll have custom chain guard grills in the future. We're not going to pick up the USB sticks. And we're always grateful to learn from you, Dustin. Thank you so much for taking the time with us twice
this
morning.
Absolutely, yes. Thank you so much.
And I look forward to seeing
such
you
a pleasure
London
to be back.
Vegas. I know, it's been a little, you know, it's lonely. We've been missing the fashion game up here. We'll have to make some fun happen at KubeCon and at GoCloud next. Jackie McGuire, we are just getting started, you and I, and it is only going to get better from here, but it is already fantastic and I'm loving it. I hope all of you are just getting your security engines revved over there, wherever you might be on this beautiful rock. We're here in San Francisco, California at ChainGuard Assemble. My name's Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.